All right, welcome back. An exciting day. Today we start a really interesting story in Numbers chapter 22, but also we find out why there's a talking donkey on the PDF outline. If you didn't know, today you will discover why. Okay, so let's first deal with our main characters. Who are they? First, Balak. We have not been introduced to him. He is the son of Zippor. He was the king of Moab. And kind of our main character for this chapter, Balaam. Son of Beor, he was from Pethor of Mesopotamia, so he was not part of like the Israelite camp, and he was a practitioner of divination. And then finally we have the angel of the Lord. God sent his angel to oppose Balaam when he was on his way to visit Balak, the king of Moab. So in terms of our timeline, we are getting towards the end of the Israelites' 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. They are really coming into the land of Canaan, or about to move into it at this point, to begin taking the land for themselves. So this happened somewhere at the tail end of 1490 to 1450 BC. In terms of the map, the Israelites haven't moved since the last chapter, at least not very much. They're at the border of the Amorites and the Moabites near Pisgah. Actually, the next couple chapters are going to be kind of the same story. The story of Balaam and Balak and the blessing and cursing of the children of Israel. So in our first section in this chapter, verses 1 through 21, Balak sins for Balaam. When Balak, the king of Moab, heard what the Israelites had done to King Sihon, King Og, and to the Amorites, which we talked about in the last chapter, he was terrified to find out that the Israelites had camped basically on his border in the plains of Moab. Balak sent messengers to a diviner named Balaam, asking him to come and to curse the Israelites to give him an advantage if he went to war against them. Balaam inquired with the Lord as to whether or not he should go to Balak and fulfill this request. God forbid Balaam from going to curse the people because he told Balaam that his blessing was on the children of Israel. Balaam told the messengers that came from King Balak that he couldn't go with them, and he couldn't speak anything that the Lord didn't permit him to speak. Balak, though, the king, persisted, and he sent another, more honorable envoy of messengers to Balaam, and he also promised him riches if he would come and curse the Israelites. So upon receiving the second set of messengers, Balak inquired of the Lord again what he should do. God told him that he could go with the men to meet with Balak, but he was strictly to follow God's instructions. So Balaam saddled his donkey, and he went on his way to visit King Balak. All right, so finally, now we get to talk about our talking donkey. The talking donkey and the angel of the Lord, verses 22 through 41. So even though God had given Balaam permission to go to Balak, something in Balaam's heart wasn't right, and God became angry at him. The angel of the Lord stood in Balaam's path with a drawn sword, and he was actually ready to kill Balaam, we'll learn later. Balaam's donkey, though, saw the angel, but Balaam did not. The angel was hidden from Balaam. The donkey veered off the road to avoid the angel, and Balaam struck the donkey for wandering off of the path in his anger. Later, the angel of the Lord stood in a narrow place between vineyards, and there were walls on either side. And the donkey, in an effort to avoid the angel, was squeezing up against one of the walls and smashed Balaam's foot against the wall in the process. Well, guess what Balaam did? He lashed out in anger again and struck his donkey. This happened a third time, where the angel was standing in a place that was so narrow that the donkey couldn't get by. And so she knelt down and just laid down on the ground. And we're told that Balaam struck the donkey a third time with his staff. Now, the Lord, quote, opened the mouth of the donkey, and she asked Balaam why he was hitting her. Balaam, seemingly unaware in his rage that he was talking to a donkey, he said that she was making a fool of him and that if he had had a sword at that moment, he would have killed her right there on the spot. But God opened Balaam's eyes and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and the angel informed him that the donkey had actually saved his life three times. And Balaam immediately acknowledged his sin at that point. The angel gave Balaam permission to go with Balak, but warned him to not do anything or say anything that God didn't give him permission to do or to say. So King Balak then met Balaam in Moab and took him to a place called Bamoth Baal to see the multitude of the camp of Israel and to get Balaam ready to make his curse on the people. So that is chapter 22. It's quite an interesting chapter. We have a talking donkey. We have, you know, Balaam's situation. We're not exactly told what was wrong in his heart, why God was so angry at him in this chapter, but evidently something was up with him. We also learn that God, well, this is a good example to show us that God had relations with the other nations in the world other than just the Israelites, because Balaam's not an Israelite, at least as far as we know. He's from Mesopotamia, and yet he has some kind of relationship with the one true God. So God was doing things outside of what we read about in the Bible. The Bible story is mainly focused on Israel, and that's the history that it records. But there's no reason to think God wasn't doing other things in other areas of the world. Let's finish off now with our application. You can follow God's commands externally with the wrong heart. Balaam waited for God's permission to go to Balak, which was a good thing, but something was wrong internally. Something was wrong in his heart. God is pleased with us when our obedience flows from a pure heart. And Jesus really emphasized this when he was teaching in Galilee and in Jerusalem. He regularly warned against the Pharisees, the scribes, the Sadducees, because while they strictly adhered to God's laws externally, the hearts that motivated their actions were self-centered and they were full of pride. So we need to be doing regular checkups on our hearts and evaluating what motivates our actions. That's especially true when we consider our religious actions, because that's where Satan does some of his most deceitful and deceptive work, convincing people that, well, because I obey God's commands and I checked off the boxes, my heart must be right, my life must be in alignment with God. Not necessarily if your heart isn't in the right place.